Hi, everybody. It's me, Jason Torchinsky. I'm here in my basement, but instead of a usual Torchinsky Files episode, this time I want to do something a little more specific. I want to talk about electric cars, and not just generally about electric cars. I want to talk about the timeline of electric cars, because even though we tend to think of them as something really modern, the truth is they've been around for almost 200 years. So why don't we go through that whole timeline of electric cars and let me divide it up into three big chunks that I've decided are important. You ready for this? Of course you are. When it comes to the timeline of electric cars, I've arbitrarily decided to divide the 200-year span into about three chunks. Not about, literally, three chunks. I call these chunks the Contender Era, the Crap Era, and then the Tesla Era. Today, I just want to talk about the beginnings of electric cars in the Contender Era. So the reason I call this the Contender Era is because this was the era where electric cars were an actual viable contender to be the dominant form of automobile. And when you think about it, all of the cars of the era, in fact, really every car ever, when it comes to how that car moves, all the mechanisms and inside it, all they really want to do is do one basic thing. And that's spin a shaft. That's it. It's just how you get a shaft spinning, and then on that shaft you can attach a transmission and gears and wheels, and then you've got a moving vehicle. But fundamentally, the only thing they're actually doing is spinning a shaft. So the very first one was steam. Steam was the first way we were able to spin shafts, pretty much in general, in a mechanized way, you know, like water wheels and stuff like that. So steam, of course, you're boiling water to make steam. Steam pushes a piston. That piston pushes down against a crankshaft, and that crankshaft translates the up and down or side to side motion of the piston into rotational motion, and then from there you can connect it to gears and wheels and all that stuff. Steam had been around since the 1700s. It's where the Industrial Revolution started with, and steam cars were a known quantity. And in fact, locomotives are really a form of automobile, and it was well established. So in this early era, steam was the safe bet. Then there's gasoline. Gasoline is similar to steam in the sense that it requires combustion. Of course, it's internal instead of external, and that combustion pushes pistons up and down or side to side, and then those pistons connect to a crankshaft, which again translates the reciprocating motion into rotational motion, and then to gears, wheels, etc., etc. So a lot of work, again, to get to a spinning shaft. Gasoline was a lot better than steam in some ways in that you didn't have to wait for as much water to boil. The energy density of gasoline is actually excellent, so you had a fair amount of power in a fairly small space. Now electric and electric motors are interesting because they spin the shaft the easiest way of all of them. You just use magnetic fields and a shaft and you get immediate a spinning shaft. Electric motors are actually a whole level of magnitude simpler than either steam engines or gasoline engines. However, the storage of the electricity is the problem and continues to be the fundamental sticking point for electric cars up until the present day, really, even though it's a lot better now. We can kind of peg the very beginning of when this was possible into the mid-1820s. There was someone named Agnos, I believe they were Hungarian, made a model electric car using a very simple electric motor. In 1832, a guy named Anderson made the Anderson Electric, also the first car to have electric lighting on it. It was like a little three-wheeled thing. It was using a non-rechargeable battery, so that was kind of an issue. You'd have to change out the batteries completely every time you used it, but it was a start. And again, it was still fairly minimal. Now, in 1835, Thomas Davenport, who was an American, made what is often considered to be the first really practical electric motor. And of course, he was building on the work of many people who came before then. And then the other key component for making an electric car, other than a motor that could actually do the work really well, were the batteries and the energy storage system. And Gaston Plante, I may be saying that wrong, he was the first to come up with the lead acid battery, which became the standard for electric car battery storage for a long, long time, well into the 20th century. And it's still basically the same technology that your car's 12-volt battery uses today. The reasons that electric cars were so viable in this early period is because, unlike gas cars or steam cars, they were really, really simple to use. They were quiet. They were easy to get started. On a gas car of this era, if you wanted to start it, you had to turn a hand crank, and that was often hard. And if it backfired, it could break your arm. Cars were smelly. Gasoline was smelly. They made exhaust. It was loud and noisy. There were a lot of mechanical parts. Early gasoline cars were difficult things to use and manage, but electric cars were crazy easy. You could get in, there's a go pedal and a stop pedal, and that's it. It was really, really easy. That's why electric cars were always advertised as being, like, more refined and classier and stately. They were targeted more heavily at women who were smart enough not to want to deal with all the mess of breaking arms with hand cranks and fumes and gas and exhaust and stuff. And that's why when you see their advertising, they tend to show elegant scenes. Look at this one in this Waverly Electric. It's called the Silent Waverly, because compared to gas cars, it was. If you were looking at all of the options for cars in, say, 1910, you would be extremely likely to say, of all of these, electric cars are going to be the way to go. They're simpler, cleaner, they're quieter, they drive better. All of these are valid reasons and made a lot of sense. The electric car in this early era had some actual real big achievements. The very first car to go a mile a minute, 60 miles an hour, 100 kilometers an hour, was this car right here, the Jamais Content. It looked like a crazy torpedo with a guy riding on top of it like the dude from Dr. Strangelove, but it was an electric car, a streamlined, or as much as they understood it of the era, a streamlined electric car, and it was fast, and it was the cutting edge bit of automotive technology of the time. Electric cars kind of lost their advantage once the oil boom kind of started in Texas, and gasoline prices became much less and gas became much more plentiful and easy to get. The advantage of electric cars in that you could recharge them anywhere was really just limited to cities. Cities like New York, for a while, had more electric cars than gasoline cars. But you get out of the cities into rural areas and you couldn't always guarantee on easy access to electricity, and then gas cars became much more popular. America was a big, big country. The limited ranges of EV batteries just wasn't enough to handle it, especially in the face of energy-dense, cheap gasoline. By 1920, 1925 or so, electric cars as a viable contender were pretty much dead, and the gasoline car had definitively won the race. And they would continue, of course, to dominate throughout the 20th century. Now, the second era that we're going to talk about next, the crap era, represents an interesting time in electric cars, and it's possibly my favorite of all the eras. So stick around for next episode when we talk about the crap era.